Thank you very much, Peter, and thank you very much, everyone, for coming. And speaking on Herodotus's behalf, I know that he would be both delighted and surprised to find that he was a hay festival author. He'd be delighted because, of course, he's been dead for 2,500 years, so I imagine he's probably the oldest author who's ever been here. And he'd be surprised because he didn't believe that the British Isles actually existed. In a wonderful throwaway comment, he says, people say that there is an island out in the North Ocean, but never having met anyone who's ever been there, I don't believe it. Well, but here we are, and here Herodotus is. And I am delighted to be here batting for him, because for me, Herodotus has been one of the two great loves of my life. The first, of course, my wife. Second, Herodotus. Almost a similar level of intimacy. Because Herodotus has actually been my companion since I was about 12. He was the very first classic that I read. So I read him before Jane Austen or Dickens or anyone like that. And the reason for that was that I'd moved seamlessly from a childhood obsession with dinosaurs, so big, ferocious, glamorous, extinct beings, to a childhood obsession with Spartans, big, ferocious, glamorous, extinct beings. So you can see a sort of natural crossover. And I got given a wonderful book by a man called Peter Connolly. Some of you may have read and looked at some of his stuff. He was a great writer, but also a great illustrator, died a couple of years ago. And this book was simply called The Greek Armies. And it had a whole section on the Battle of Thermopylae, the great conflict where the Spartans died heroically, and had a magnificent illustration. Kind of got me really hooked. And it wasn't long before I became utterly obsessed with the whole narrative of the Persian Wars. And the reason for that was that, essentially, as I understood it back then, the plot was the plot of Lord of the Rings, only true. As it's traditionally told, you have an evil empire in the east, Persia, that comes in swarming out with vast, overwhelming numbers to attack the freedom-loving peoples of the West, aka the Greeks. And heroically, at a series of titanic battles at Marathon, at Thermopylae, of course, at Salamis, and then at Plataea, the Greeks, against all the odds, see the Persians off. And it's fabulous, gripping, heroic, stirring stuff. I was utterly hooked. But it didn't take me long to realize that if I was really going to get to grips with this amazing story, I was going to have to go to Herodotus, the man who 2,500 years ago wrote about it in extraordinary detail. And of course, I was slightly intimidated about that. You know, what was it going to be like to read an actual, real-life ancient Greek? And I went to the library, and I got out not the Penguin version. My translation is Penguin, so I feel bad admitting this. I got out the Everyman version, which came in two volumes. And that in itself was intimidating. I'd never read anything that had two volumes before. Took it back home, opened it, and got stuck in. And to begin with, I was encouraged. I will read you the opening sentence, which, of course, is the first sentence of the first history ever written. So in a sense, it's history begins with this line, and it's a good one. Herodotus from Halicarnassus here displays his inquiries that human achievement may be spared the ravages of time, and that everything great and astounding, and all the glory of those exploits which served to display Greeks and barbarians alike to such effect, be kept alive. And additionally, and most importantly, to give the reason they went to war. And I thought, brilliant, war, excellent, that's what I want. So I started turning the pages with enthusiasm, only to find myself a little puzzled, because Herodotus, I discovered, had a tendency slightly to veer off-piste. rather than talking about the Persian Wars, which is what I wanted him to be talking about, he went into what to my 12-year-old mind seemed a rather weird story about a king who thought his wife was so beautiful that he wanted his bodyguard to see her naked. It ends horribly, of course. It's a Greek story. Moved on. The next thing, description of Greece's greatest musician, who goes kind of like, I don't know, One Direction or something, going on tour of America. This guy, Arion, goes on tour around Sicily, makes an absolute fortune, sailing back, group of pirates are taking him. They plan to steal all his money, make him walk the plank. Arion says, look, you know, my last request, can I dress up in my robes? Can I play the lyre one last time? And the pirates, you know, they're fans. They want to hear him, so they say, fine. He plays the lyre, then he jumps off, robes flowing, and lands on the back of a dolphin. And the dolphin takes him all the way back to his home of Corinth. And again, I think, wow, that's not what I was expecting. That's really not what I was expecting. And so it went on. And every time I thought that Herodotus was getting to grips with the story that I wanted, he'd go shooting off any old direction. So he introduces the Persians, and I'm thinking, brilliant, at last. And then he's describing how the Persians invade Egypt. And he says, because Egypt is so interesting, I'm just going to pause here a bit and tell you a little bit about Egypt. And when he says a little bit, he means about 130 pages. And so I read the whole of the first volume, and I still hadn't got to the Persian Wars. I was getting really, really impatient by this stage. Then at last, in the second volume, we get into the Persian Wars. It's this amazing accounts of Marathon and so on. And, of course, for me, the most exciting moment was when I finally got to his account of Thermopylae. The Persian king, Xerxes, the son of Darius, the man who had sent the Persian armies to Marathon, has led in person a great invasion force, 2 million people, Herodotus says, slight exaggeration. And he is met by 300 Spartans, some 5,000 other Greeks, at a tiny narrow pass at Thermopylae, the Hot Gates. And for 2.5 days, the Greeks heroically see off the overwhelming forces of Asia that are ranged against them. And Xerxes is going spare, but then we are told a traitor, Epialtes, approaches Xerxes and says, look, there's a path around the back, I'll show you. And so Xerxes sends his best force, his crack troops, and they go around the back. And so the Spartans are informed of this and they prepare for death. So I'm going to read you Herodotus' famous account of the last stand of the Spartans at Thermopylae. Xerxes, who had greeted the sun by performing libations, then delayed launching his offensive until it was roughly the time in the morning when market squares fill up. Epialtes had told him that he needed to wait only till then, because the route down from the mountain was more direct and took far less time than the ascent and the circuit of it. As Xerxes and the barbarians under him moved to the attack, so did Leonidas, who is the Spartan king, and his Greeks. Indeed, conscious that they were going out to their deaths, they advanced much deeper into the open stretch of the pass than they had done at first. While on previous days they had stood sentry behind the line of the wall and made sallies only out into the narrow reaches of the pass, now they joined battle beyond the narrows, where the barbarians suffered massive casualties. This was due to their officers, who wielded whips and would lash all the men in their respective regiments, urging them ever onwards to the front. There were many also who fell into the sea and were drowned, and even more who were trampled underfoot by their comrades while still alive. Indeed, there was no counting how many perished. The Greeks, you see, because they knew that they were going to die at the hands of the men coming round the mountain, did all they could to demonstrate to the barbarians the full force of their strength and fought in a frenzy without regard for their lives. Now, by this stage, because most of them had smashed their spears to splinters, they were using their swords to slaughter the Persians. The man who proved himself without peer in this struggle was Leonidas. But then he fell, and with him other celebrated Spartiates too, whose names as men who well merit commemoration I have made sure to learn. Indeed, I have learned the names of all the 300. On the Persian side too, there fell a whole number of eminent Persians. These included two sons of Darius, Abrocomes and Hyperanthes, born to him by Fratagune, the daughter of Artanes. So two of Xerxes' brothers fell in the battle, which raged furiously over the corpse of Leonidas, Persian against Lacedaemonian, until by sheer force of courage, the Greeks managed to grab hold of the body and send their adversaries reeling back four times. This contest continued until the soldiers arrived with Ephialtes, at which point, as the Greeks became aware of their coming, the whole character of the fighting changed. The Greeks withdrew back past the wall to where the road was narrow, and there, all of them except for the Thebans banded together and took up a position on a hillock. On this hillock, which was located in the entrance to the pass, where the stone lion commemorating Leonidas now stands, they defended themselves with daggers, if they still had them, or else with their fists and teeth. Meanwhile, the barbarians buried them beneath a hail of missiles, pulling down the defensive wall and attacking them head on, with those who had come round the mountain completing the encirclement. So gripping stuff, stirring stuff. And it's not surprising that when Hollywood came to make a Blood and Thunder epic about Greek history, they drew on that episode for 300. Now, 300 notoriously was detested in Iran for representing the Persians basically as orcs. So going back to that idea of the Persian Wars as a sort of ersatz equivalent of Lord of the Rings. And you can see why in that passage, because Herodotus is really playing up the idea of the Greeks as defenders of freedom, whereas the Persians are slaves. They have to be whipped to the front. They are the slaves of the great king, whereas the Greeks, in Herodotus' account, are fighting as free men. But to imagine from that Herodotus is a tub-thumping chauvinist, that he is shamelessly enthusiastic for the Greeks, that he, when he talks about barbarians, he is being pejorative, would be very wrong. Barbarian, in Herodotus' account, just means someone who goes ba-ba-ba-ba-ba-ba, who doesn't speak Greek. Doesn't necessarily have that negative image that it tends to have in English. And the thing is that actually, when you read the whole sweep of Herodotus' account, you can see why, many years later, an particularly intemperate Greek critic of Herodotus would call him Philobarbaros, barbarian lover, bleeding heart liberal, I guess, would be the sort of the closest translation, the most fitting translation. And the reason for that is that Herodotus does not think that the Greeks are the only ones who have cracked civilization. Just the opposite. The reason that Herodotus, when he writes, is always veering off in all kinds of direction is that he is so fascinated by how other people live, what they think, how they behave, what their achievements are, that he cannot help himself but explore and describe them in the most loving and attentive detail. And the truth is that even now, 2,500 years on, I think that Herodotus provides us with a most wonderful moral of how to cope with a world in which people have to rub up against many other different kinds of people who do have different cultures, different takes, different understandings of life. And there is a wonderful passage in here which absolutely exemplifies this. And it comes in the account that Herodotus gives of the Egyptian conquest of Egypt. And he is describing how Cambyses, who is the son of Cyrus, the first great Persian king, Cambyses is his son, has invaded Egypt, conquered it. And then having conquered it, he behaves, Cambyses behaves in an incredibly chauvinist way. He takes for granted that the Persians are better and that the Egyptians with their gods and their cults are ridiculous. And Cambyses is informed that a god has come to Egypt in the form of a bull. He goes and shoots it. He wanders into Egyptian temples and looks at their idols, you know, gods with animal heads, and bursts out laughing. And Herodotus cannot understand this. And he thinks that the only reason that someone would show such blatant disrespect for the beliefs and cultures of other people must be that Cambyses was mad. And so this is the juncture where he puts in this wonderful story. "Everywhere you look, it seems to me," he says, "the evidence accumulates that Cambyses was utterly deranged. For why otherwise would he have mocked what to others were hallowed customs? Just suppose that someone proposed to the entirety of mankind that a selection of the very best practices be made from the sum of human custom. Each group of people, after carefully sifting through the customs of other peoples, would surely choose its own. Everyone believes his own customs to be far and away the best. From this, it follows that only a madman would think to jeer at such matters. Indeed, there is a huge amount of corroborating evidence to support the conclusion that this attitude to one's own native customs is universal. Take, for example, this story from the reign of Darius. He called together some Greeks who were present and asked them how much money they would wish to be paid to devour the corpses of their fathers, to which the Greeks replied that no amount of money would suffice for that. Next, Darius summoned some Indians called Calantians, who do eat their parents, at least Herodotus says, and asked them in the presence of the Greeks, who were able to follow what was being said by means of an interpreter, how much money it would take to buy their consent to the cremation of their dead fathers, at which the Calantians cried out in horror and told him that his words were a desecration of silence. Such, then, is how custom operates. And how right the poet Pindar is, it seems to me, when he declares in his poetry that custom is the king of all." And of course, the fascinating thing about that story is that the moral pivot of it is Darius, the king of the Persians, the man who sends the army to attack Athens that gets defeated at Marathon. And the reason that Darius chooses Greeks on the one side, Indians on the other, is that these two peoples are the opposite fringes of the great Persian Empire. And the Persians have this presumption that the further you go from Persia, the more barbarous and grotesque your customs become. So what Herodotus is doing, and it's an amazing thing, he is thinking himself into the mindset of a Persian king. But more than that, he's then enabling the Persian king to serve as the kind of moral arbiter. And the implication of that is that, despite the passage I read about Thermopylae, that actually Herodotus has a huge admiration for the Persians, the people who were the overlords of his own hometown of Halicarnassus, now the Turkish yachting town of Bodrum, but also, of course, had invaded Greece and caused such suffering and carnage. But Herodotus, when he looks at the Persians and tries to make sense of them, he sees much in them to admire. One thing he particularly admires, for instance, he admires their education system. He says that Persian children, and that includes girls as well as boys, again, something very distinctive to the Persians, he says that they're taught three things: to ride, to shoot, to tell the truth. That's all you need. It's the kind of thing that Michael Gove might possibly pick up on. Solve a lot of problems, perhaps. And Herodotus really, really approves of that. And amazingly, we've heard that he casts Darius in this amazing light, but he also casts Xerxes, the great king who leads the campaign, who is the commander at Thermopylae. There are times where he casts Xerxes in an incredibly positive light as well. And one of them is one of the most dramatic moments in the whole histories, and it's where Xerxes is about to cross from Asia into Europe. And of course, in the opinion of Herodotus, this is an appalling thing to do because the gods have separated these two continents by means of the Hellespont. Xerxes has chosen to bridge them with two great pontoon bridges. And he sees this as monstrously hubristic, that it is simply asking for the gods to punish him. And that, of course, is one of the themes that runs throughout the later stages of the book, is that Xerxes has overreached, he has aspired too high, he has taken on for himself the role of a god, and therefore he must be punished. But there is an amazing moment just before the Persians cross the Hellespont where Herodotus, in his account of Xerxes, permits him to have a recognition of this. So Xerxes is in Abydos on the shores of the Hellespont, and he decides that he wants to review his entire task force. Dais of white stone, built beforehand by the people of Abydos on the orders of the king himself, had already been raised on a hill expressly for him. And Xerxes, as he sat and gazed down from this vantage point onto the shore and beheld both his land forces and his fleet, had a longing to see the ships compete in a race. This contest, when it was duly staged, was won by the Phoenicians from Sidon. And Xerxes was delighted by the sport and indeed by his entire task force. It was then, at the sight of the Hellespont completely covered by his ships, and the entire shoreline and plain of Abydos filled up with his men, that Xerxes considered himself blessed, and afterwards began to weep. When Artabanus, his uncle, and the man who initially had freely broadcast his opposition to the invasion of Greece and advised Xerxes against it, saw that his nephew was in tears, he inquired as to the reason. "What a difference, O king, between your behavior now and that of only a short time before. Then you considered yourself blessed. Now you weep." "Yes," Xerxes answered, "for I was musing on how short is human life, and the pity of it pierced me through. All these multitudes here, and yet in 100 years' time, not one of them will be alive." And of course, Xerxes is including himself among the number of those who will be dead. And it is not a Persian perspective. It is the perspective of a Greek. It is a perspective that is tragic. But nevertheless, that does not alter the power of Herodotus' attempt to think himself into the mindset of a Persian king and to portray it sympathetically. And the reason that that is important is that it provides the key to understanding why, when we call his book Histories, that is inadequate. In Greek, historia means inquiries, researches, and it doesn't come to have the meaning that it has for us in Greek until about 100 years on from the lifetime of Herodotus, and largely in due part to his own influence. So what Herodotus is doing is giving us not just a portrait of the Persian Wars, and this is what I had not understood when I first read it. What he is doing is giving us a portrait of the entire world as he understands it, because in Herodotus' opinion, what has changed is that the Persian Empire is so immense, so vast, that when it invades Europe, effectively the future of the entire world is at stake. And so therefore, to understand what is happening, to adequately represent the full scale of what is up for grabs, he has to represent and portray and give sketches of everybody and everything in the world. And that completely suits his program, because essentially Herodotus is obsessed with everything. He wants to know everything. And so he, for the first time ever, we have in Herodotus someone who is trying to explain not just the sweep and scale of the world. Other people had done that. There had been geographers. But to try and track people down, interview them, find out why things had happened, to secure his report. And for me, this is, again, one of the most moving things reading it now. We think about... I imagine that the whole issue of interviewing veterans of wars is much in people's mind at the moment. It's the, you know, we're coming up to the anniversary of D-Day, and of course we've got the centenary of the outbreak of the First World War. So there will be a lot of programs in which people who lived through the experience of those wars are interviewed. But the very first interview with a veteran of a war appears in Herodotus. And he introduces it just before the final great battle, the great land battle of Plataea, which sees the Greeks once and for all finish the Persian military threat to Greece. The Persian commander, a man called Mardonius, has set up camp in Thebes, the Greek city of Thebes, which has sided with the Persians. And on the eve of the battle, to try and fuse the Thebans with the Persians, he holds a great banquet in which the Thebans and the Persians sort of sit together and have a chat and get ready for the big event. And Herodotus interviews someone who had been at that banquet. And so he says, with great pride, the following story I heard from Thasander of Orchomenus, a man of the highest reputation in his own city. Thasander told me that he too was invited by Ataginus to the banquet, together with 50 men from Thebes, and that the Thebans and the Persians, rather than being kept apart, were instead placed together, one Theban and one Persian to every couch. After the meal was over, they continued drinking, and the Persian who was sharing Thasander's couch asked him in Greek where he came from. Orchomenus, answered Thasander. Then the Persian said, now that we have shared a table and poured a libation from the same cup, I would like to leave you with memorials of my thoughts. In that way, your eyes will be open to what is coming, and you will be able to plan ahead with your own best interests in mind. Just look at these Persians busy with their banqueting and gaze upon the army we left camped out along the river. So many to see, and yet in just a short time, only a fraction of them will survive. And even as the Persian said this, the tears poured down his cheeks. Thasander, nonplussed by his comments, asked him, should you not be mentioning this to Mardonius and to the Persians with him, who are particularly well regarded? No, my friend, he answered. There is nothing any man can do to avert what the god has decreed. Even if you speak entirely reliably, no one ever wants to believe you. Plenty of Persians have grasped how things stand, but necessity has us fettered, and so we must follow. Of all the miseries to which men are prey, this is the most hateful, to understand something fully, but be impotent to effect it. Something, perhaps, that was on people's mind in the recent elections. All this I heard from Thasander of Orchomenus, and he told me, too, that he informed people about it then and there, well before the battle came to be fought at Plataea. Now, it may be that Thasander of Orchomenus is giving a Greek spin on what his Persian companion said. I mean, it rather sounds like it to me. Again, as with Xerxes weeping over the thought of everyone who will die, the sentiments of the Persian are kind of Hellenized. But that doesn't alter the power of that passage to send a shiver down the spine. Because what you're hearing are the words of a veteran of a battle that was fought 2,500 years ago. It's an amazing moment. And you get moments like this throughout Herodotus's work because there are moments everywhere where you think, yes, I can see what Herodotus was doing there. I can see who he spoke to. I can almost hear the people that he was interviewing to get this material. And it's so amazing. I mean, it's like, you know, it's so long ago. And that there you have glimpses of this wonderful, amazing, inquisitive, original man going round his world, interviewing people, questioning them, grilling them. And there are times where he says, and this is his get out of jail card, so you know the account I gave of the man jumping off the boat and being rescued by the dolphin. Herodotus doesn't necessarily believe these stories, but what he says is, this is what I was told, and so therefore I am going to tell you. And there's a wonderful example of this where he expresses his doubt about something that he's been told. And it actually demonstrates that what he's been told is true. And the most famous example of this comes where he interviews the Phoenicians, who were great seafarers from what's now Lebanon. And they were commissioned by one of the pharaohs of Egypt to sail round Africa, what the Greeks called Libya, and see whether you could go all the way round. And the Phoenicians set off down the Red Sea, and then they claim to have re-emerged through the Straits of Gibraltar, the Pillars of Hercules, as they were called, and to have come back to Egypt. And Herodotus says, well, this is obviously ludicrous. You can't possibly sail around Libya. And he says, one of their claims, the Phoenician claims, which I personally find incredible, although others may not, was that while sailing around Libya, they had had the sun on their right-hand side. And that, of course, is precisely the detail that enables us to know that the Phoenicians were telling the truth and that they had indeed sailed around Africa because they must have crossed the equator for that to be true. Herodotus doubts it, but his very expression of doubt enables us to see that what he's reporting is in fact accurate. And there are a whole gamut of wonders in his history. And at the when I was 12, I wished that he'd just cut to the chase. I just wanted the war. Now, it's the other way around. I wish that he'd written even more, because the perspective it gives on the world of the 5th century BC is so precious and so fascinating. So there are all kinds of wonders. There are wonders that sound to Herodotus weird, but which we know are true. So here's an example of one that is weird but true. And it comes in his account of the Scythians, who are people who live in what is now Ukraine. And Herodotus is describing the fauna, and then he moves on to the flora. Now, there is a plant in their country, he says, called cannabis, which closely resembles flax, except that it has a thicker stem and is larger in size. In these respects, cannabis has by far the advantage. It grows both wild and as a result of cultivation, and is even used by the Thracians to make clothes that closely resemble linen. Indeed, only a real specialist can distinguish clothes made from flax from those made from the cannabis plant. Someone who has never seen cannabis before would think the clothes to be linen. So, what the Scythians do is to take the seeds of a cannabis plant, crawl in under the blankets, and cast the seeds onto glowing stones. As they hit the stones, the seeds flare as though they were incense, and emit a vapor so thick that no steam bath in Greece could possibly compete with it. The effect of this vapor on the Scythians is to make them howl with delight. So we know that that's right. Then there are things that are weird. And have traditionally been used to condemn Herodotus, not as the father of history, as Cicero called him, but as the father of lies. And a particularly notorious example of this, which I've now just managed to lose my place. Bother. Sorry. Anyway, as I'm looking for it, it's set in India. And Herodotus is describing how the Indians, who are very rich in gold, managed to get their gold. And he says that there are ants, and these ants are absolutely huge. They're the size of dogs, and they dig up the gold. And the Indians go out and they grab the gold, and then they have to run off. And he says, once the Indians, complete with sacks, have arrived at their destination, so where the ants have been digging up the gold, they fill up their sacks with the sand, which is impregnated with the gold dust, and then go careering off home as fast as they possibly can. The reason for this, as reported by the Persians, is that the ants pick up on their scent and give them chase. Now, there is nothing in the world quite as fast as these ants, to the degree that none of the Indians, were they to fail in getting a head start while the ants were massing, would make it back to safety. The male camels, because they are not as fleet-footed as the female ones, start to lag and may even end up being cut loose one after the other. The females, however, with memories of their abandoned young fresh in their minds, do not slacken. And that, so the Persians say, is how the Indians obtain the greater part of their gold. Now, ants the size of dogs that are faster than any other animal in the world. It's unsurprising that people have always laughed at this. But there has actually been a wonderful theory about what Herodotus might actually have been talking about, proposed by a French scholar a few decades back, where he pointed out that in Kashmir there are marmosets that on a plane that do indeed dig holes and throw up dirt, and in this dirt there has been found gold dust. And he proposed that what Herodotus thought were ants might in fact have been marmosets, and it's understandable, Herodotus didn't speak any language apart from Greek, so far as we can tell, that the process of Chinese whispers, the reports of these animals going all the way from North India to Greece, perhaps he just got the word wrong, and he didn't get it, you know, that there is a basis of fact to it, so perhaps we shouldn't be so quick to sneer at him. That said, there are certain things that Herodotus just got square wrong. For instance, he tells us with an immense sense of confidence that the semen of Indians and Ethiopians is black. And it was pointed out by Aristotle a century later that this was not the case. And of course, Aristotle was a great one for the empirical method. I'd love to know exactly how he worked that out. But of course, Aristotle is true. Herodotus was not. And then there are wonders where you just think, I've no idea what Herodotus was on when he did this. For me, the most bewildering one is a description that he gives of going to Egypt. And he gives us all kinds of accounts of things that he saw in Egypt. There can be no doubt that he did go there. He describes things that have only been sort of revealed by archaeologists much later. He tells stories that have been found on scraps of papyri just recently. So it's clear that he really did go to Egypt. And when he says that he spoke to the priests, you know, he really did speak to them. I mean, that said, an awful lot of what the priests told him seems to have been absolute rubbish. You get the definite sense of the priests wetting themselves with laughter as they get Herodotus to believe yet another tall story. My favourite one is, Herodotus, of course, fascinated by the pyramids, as everyone who goes to Egypt is. He wants to explain how it was that the small pyramids in front of the Great Pyramid were built. And again, with sublime self-confidence, he says, the priests told me how these small pyramids got built. The small pyramid was built by Cheops, who built the Great Pyramid. It's built by Cheops' daughter, who funded it by setting herself up as a prostitute and made enough money that she could then fund this small pyramid. And if she'd done it a bit longer, then the pyramid would have been bigger. obviously, that's what, you know, the priests told him that. And he reproduces it, and it's, bless him. But the one that's puzzling is he has this description of how there are flying snakes in Arabia. And he says that every year the flying snakes come in a great swarm to Egypt, and they would burst into Egypt were it not for the fact that ibises in a great flock man the pass, a bit like the Spartans at Thermopylae, and kill all the snakes. And he says, and I myself have been to this valley, and I have seen the skeletons of these winged snakes. And I have never read a convincing description, a convincing explanation as to what Herodotus might have seen. I mean, my favourite, perhaps there were sort of, you know, pterodactyls or something back then that we just haven't found out. I'd like to think that that was the reason. If anyone has an idea as to what Herodotus might have seen there, please do let me know. And so that was why, as I say, he has had this reputation as the father of lies, as well as the father of history. But I think it, for the reasons that I've spelt out, it is incredibly unfair. And for us to, in the age of Google, in the age of the internet, in the age of Wikipedia, to dismiss Herodotus because he gets some things wrong, because he is gullible about some stories that to us clearly seem far-fetched, would be a scandalous failure to appreciate the extraordinary measure of what he is setting out to do. Because what Herodotus essentially is doing, in an age where narrative had generally involved the gods, had obeyed the rhythms of epic or of poetry, what Herodotus is doing is not just to invent history, he is inventing the very notion of non-fiction. And I think that we perhaps can see that more clearly now than we would have done, say, 30 years ago. Because I think that the development of the internet, that way in which we're all now familiar, that if we want to find something out, we follow a lead, we follow a lead, we follow a lead, you're surfing the web, you find yourself discovering things that you never knew existed. That pretty well is what Herodotus is doing, albeit in a world where, of course, you know, there's no internet, but also no one had even thought about trying to understand the world in that way. And so whenever we go on a search engine and we type something in, we are following in the footsteps of Herodotus. We're following a course that he blazed. And I think that there are ways now of reading Herodotus with the internet in the mind that simply would never have occurred to people before. There's famously, Herodotus promises that he is going to... He describes Assyria, so the kingdom north of Babylon, describes Babylon in great detail. But he says, I'm not going to talk about Assyria now, I'll talk about it later. And he never does. And the experience for me of reading that is it's akin to the frustration of hitting on a link and finding that it's gone dead. I would give anything to have Herodotus' account of Assyria, but he just never wrote it. But what he did write, it's big. You know, it's the longest work of ancient Greek prose that there is, but I wish it was longer. As I said, Herodotus has been a companion for almost as long as I've been reading. And he is one of those writers who evolves as you evolve. So the Herodotus that I read when I was 12 is now very different to the Herodotus that I have in my head now. And I can only thank Penguin for commissioning me to do this translation, because, of course, you know, I compared Herodotus to my wife. She wouldn't be pleased with. In a sense, doing a translation is a bit like marrying. It's kind of make or break. You will either end up confirmed in your love or I never want to have anything to do with him. And I remember when I finished Herodotus, when I translated the very last sentence, I felt, you know, great sense of relief, sense of achievement, but also of bereavement, because I knew that I would never again have the kind of closeness to this wonderful, inquisitive, endlessly charming man that I had had while going through the process of translating him. He is the most wonderful, wonderful author. I'm delighted to have had the chance to talk about him. And please, if you haven't read him, you have such a treat in store. He truly is the most wonderful man. Thank you very much. If anyone has any questions, very happy to try and answer them.
Hi, Tom. I just wondered if actually translating it provides any difficulties, you know, from the text to modern English.
Well yes, there are obvious difficulty I alluded to in the talk I gave, which is how you translate barbarian. It has different shades of meaning over the course of the text. There are places where it does have the sense that it has in English. There are, you know, as in the passage about Thermopylae I read, I think barbarian there does have a kind of negative sense. But as I say, there are other places where he just means foreigner. And so one decision that you have to make is whether you are going to change the meaning. So you might put barbarian in one place or foreigner in another. And I decided not to, so I decided to keep barbarian. Simply because I think that the context explains the sense in which Herodotus is using it. And I think that it is a word that hopefully, as you read it, you will appreciate the fact that it is changing. There are some passages that are, I found, incredibly difficult to make sense of. And interestingly, the passages that I found hardest were where he is providing kind of topographical descriptions of places that I think he hadn't been to. And I kind of second sense that where he's describing places he has been to, the description is very sharp, and the Greek is immediately comprehensible. Where he's describing chiefly the rivers of Scythia, which, you know, I've said how brilliant and fascinating Herodotus is. Whenever he writes about a river, he is yawnably dull. So there's a sort of big stretch about the Nile, about 10 pages, skip it, unless you're very interested. And then there's a couple of pages about the rivers of Scythia, which again, interminably dull. And I sort of got the sense that perhaps Herodotus himself isn't really very interested in this. I found that very, very difficult to get a handle on what he was meaning and saying. So I would say that those topographical passages are perhaps were the hardest to translate.
My question is more or less the same one. I mean, the saying is the Greeks have a word for it. Was Greek in his day, which is quite early, isn't it? Was it apt to what he was doing, or is it being worked on by later generations who had the language of Aristotle and Plato and the dramatists?
Herodotus has the language of Homer. And again, there was a sort of hint of that in the passage about Thermopylae that I read, where if you remember, Leonidas dies, and the Greeks and the Persians fight over his body. Now, how the hell how did he know that? They all died. I mean, that's the whole point. No one to report it. But what you get there is an echo of the drama in the Iliad, where the Greeks and the Trojans fight over the corpse, say, of Patroclus. And Herodotus is consciously echoing Homer, and there are passages throughout it where he has a consciously epic tone. Similarly, he has the example. I mean, he comes from this amazing upsurge of fascination with the world, and the only real comparison with it would be the 18th century Enlightenment in Western Europe, and it's centered on Ionia, which is what's now the Turkish seaboard of the Aegean. And you have philosophers, what we'd now call natural scientists, geographers, all trying to make sense of the world in human terms. And what Herodotus is doing is to apply that methodology to the study of the past and to the entire sweep of global history and global affairs. So those really are the twin poles around which Herodotus' Greek are operating. It's the Homeric, epic, poetic inheritance of Greek, and the more sort of sparser, I suppose you could almost describe academic texts of these philosophers and geographers, about whom I have to say, Herodotus, I've been saying, he's a lovely guy, I think. He'd definitely be someone I would want to spend time with. But the only time he's really bitchy is about a guy called Hecataeus, who was a geographer from his neck of the woods. And Herodotus really has it in for him. He only ever quotes him to have a sneer. So I would say that the twin poles are Homer, who Herodotus acknowledges, and Hecataeus, who he pretends he has nothing to do with, but who is equally quite a significant influence, I think. But having said that, you know, Herodotus is incomparable. There is no Herodotus before Herodotus. What does Herodotus say about women? Okay. Herodotus seems to have been fascinated by women. And he seems to have been fascinated by the different ways in which women and men led their lives. If you compare him with Thucydides, I don't think there's a single mention of a woman in Thucydides. There must be, but I mean, women just don't enter the Thucydides equation. In Herodotus' history, the first woman who appears is this wife of King Candales, who I described, who, again, Herodotus says, as though it's incredibly weird, that the husband thought his wife was incredibly beautiful. And he says, well, how odd is that? The husband thought his wife was beautiful. And he gets his bodyguard to see his wife naked, hides him in the bedroom, and the wife strips off, then gets into bed, and the bodyguard slips out. But the wife sees the bodyguard do it. And Herodotus says that for women of the East to be seen, you know, unveiled, is the most shaming thing imaginable. And so the queen then goes to him and says, look, you know, either you kill my husband for the insult he's done me, or I'm going to kill you. And that's the kind of feistiness that queens in Herodotus tend to display the whole way through. And any of you who've have seen the pretty dreadful sequel to 300, it features Ava Green as looking very pulchritudinous as Artemisia, the queen of Halicarnassus, which is, of course, the city that Herodotus came from. In the film, she is she's cast as kind of this psycho dominatrix. In Herodotus, she leads a squadron. She's a queen who leads a quite small squadron. But because she comes from Herodotus' home city, he's incredibly proud of her, even though she's fighting for the Persian side. And she gets cornered at the Battle of Salamis, the great naval battle. An Athenian ship is bearing down on her, so she swings around and rams one of her own side, which promptly sinks, and she's able to get away. And Xerxes is up on the cliff watching it and thinks that she's rammed a Greek ship and says, you know, my men have become women, my women have become men. And that's a sort of a balance, the way in which women behave like as Greeks think men should behave and vice versa, that Herodotus is compulsively interested in. I mean, I could just spend, you know, how long have I got? I go on and on and on about how fascinating Herodotus' portrayal of all the various ways in which women and men interrelate throughout the history. But the best thing to do is to read it. Or buy it and read it. The Babylonian marriage market. Brilliant. That's all I'm going to say.
Hello. Over here. Down here. Hello.
Ah, yes.
Thank you so much for that. I love the ants, dolphins, and flying snakes. Are they the wildest tales Herodotus has for us? And also, how far away are his furthest tales coming from? China, Russia, or not?
I'm so glad you asked me that. I think the ants one is the notorious one. There is another one which I think does take us to China, possibly takes us to China. Herodotus, in his account of the Scythians, so this is... you've got to imagine the great sweep of Central Asia, so going from the Ukraine north of the Black Sea ever eastwards. And there's an amazing kind of John Mandeville quality to Herodotus' account of this. I mean, stories of people with one foot and, you know, people who live up trees and all that kind of thing. Calvino quality to it. And he describes that right at the furthest limits of the East, there are griffins who live on the sides of mountains and they guard gold. And the locals will creep up, and it's a bit like the giant ant story, they will creep up the mountainside and grab the gold and then run off. And the griffins, of course, have beaks like eagles. And and Herodotus says that they're a cross between a lion and a bird. And there's a wonderful theory that what this is a garbled echo of is of the mountains that guard the Gobi Desert in Mongolia, so almost China. And that in these mountains, there are the skeletons of Protoceratops, one of the very first ceratopsian dinosaurs that would evolve into Triceratops. Didn't have any horns, but did have this beak. And if you... You know, knowing what we now know about the relationship between birds and dinosaurs, actually a description of Protoceratops as a cross between a lion and a bird is not bad at all. And the thesis is, which I think is a wonderful one, is that Herodotus is reporting a garbled account of this, that he's describing a mountain face in which these Protoceratops skulls are emerging as they weather, and that this is being repeated back as an account of griffins. I have no idea whether that theory is true. I like to think it is. Maybe it isn't. But I think it's, you know, again and again, when you look at Herodotus' stories and you try to make sense of them, you can always find ways in which this process of, in this case, literally Chinese whispers might have operated. And that, again, is, you know, is part of the huge fun of reading him.
All these places, and was he generally welcome when he got there?
I imagine he must have been. Herodotus is in town, woohoo! There is, that in the 70s, there was a kind of... there was an argument that was very popular among academics that Herodotus had never actually been to any of the places that he described, and that all he was interested in doing was providing portraits of people who were not like the Greeks, and that was the point. As I said, that argument I think now has hasn't been blown out of the water, but it's been refined, because it's clear from recent finds in Egypt, as I said, the papyrus finds, that he's reproducing stories that were authentic to Egypt. He must have, if he didn't go to Scythia, he must have spoken to people who authentically did go there, and we know that because Herodotus gives an account of the burial of Scythian kings, and he says that spikes, a great hole is dug in the ground, and spikes are dug into the ground, and they get horses, chop them up, and stick them on these spikes, so that and then they put the body of the dead king on the horse, so that he's buried riding his horse and then tombed up. And no one had ever found any proof of that. But a few years ago, four or five years ago, a tomb in Scythia was found from the 5th century BC that exactly mapped this description. That doesn't prove that Herodotus himself saw it, but it proves that he certainly interviewed people who must have seen something like it. The big question is whether he went to Babylon. I think he did, because he gets things... Actually, interestingly, because he gets things wrong. He gets them wrong in the kind of way that, you know, if I went to Bangkok and had to write about it, I'd probably get things wrong. But it's possible that he didn't. How he generally got around, I think very difficult to know much about his life. He doesn't give many clues within the history, but he does have a very keen interest, not just in the East, so the Persian Empire, but also in the West, so the Mediterranean. So he describes the Carthaginians and the Etruscans. Doesn't mention Rome, interestingly. Even Spain, he's interested in Spain. So I think that he was probably involved in Mediterranean trade somehow, and that is probably what gave him his opportunity to interview all these various people. We have no account of anyone meeting Herodotus, but the fact that he clearly spoke to so many people who were so willing to tell him stories, even if they were incredibly tall stories, I think speaks very well of his charm, which is evident anyway throughout the whole book. I mean, I defy anyone to read Herodotus and not come away thinking he must have been a wonderful person.
Who was he writing for?
The Greeks never did anything unless there was an element of competition about it. So, you know, the idea of a literary festival where you just turn up and give a talk, absolutely, what's the point of that? There has to be a competition. You know, I have to have more people than Sebastian Folkes. I dream on. But that would be the point. So Herodotus is going around all these equivalent of literary festivals, but they're competitions, and he's out to win. So he will be reading this stuff out, and that's why it has such a dramatic quality to it. Although it's beautiful prose, it's also a real quality of the oral to it. And he is, you know, it's agonistic. He is part of the agon, the contest to... And he's out to win. And when Thucydides then comes to write his history, he is basically taking Herodotus on. Thucydides never mentions Herodotus except anonymously to diss him. But it's evident that the entire way in which Thucydides writes, which is focused on Greece, which is focused on war and politics, which has no interest in, you know, flying ants or women, is very consciously a riposte to Herodotus. And that sense of Herodotus and Thucydides as great rivals locked in a kind of eternal combat has persisted right the way to the present day. I think if you think about historians who are writing now, it's pretty easy to divide them up into Herodotean or Thucydidean historians.
Sorry, a follow-on question from that. I guess in the age of the internet and YouTube, do you think there's still room for a Herodotus when facts can be revised instantly and sources of wonder are at our fingertips? Or should we really see him affectionately as a first historian of documenting, synthesizing, and narrating?
I think that he has elements of two things in the present day. He has the element of Wikipedia. That's his ambition, to write the Wikipedia of the 5th century BC. And that's why basically he tries to put everything he possibly can in. And just as Wikipedia will have errors, so of course Herodotus' history has errors. But he is also you know, he is a great documentary presenter. If you know, the BBC wants a new presenter for Civilization, were Herodotus around, he would be perfect for it. And on that note, I think that I have to end. Thank you very, very much.